Welcome to the Marketing Growth Podcast. This podcast episode is sponsored by Ahrefs. I'm your host, Shane Barker, and my guest today is Eric Qualman, the five-time best-selling writer and motivational speaker. Eric is also the creator of Social Media Revolution, the most watched social video globally. His company, Equalmen, produces digital leadership materials and disruptive video stories for businesses. In today's episode, we're going to talk about his digital marketing journey. Let's learn more about how he comes up with his groundbreaking books, videos, and resources. Before we talk to Eric, I'm curious on how my listeners drive traffic to their content and pages. Truth be told, I find it to be a huge challenge. With over 1.5 million pieces of content being produced every minute, it's kind of hard to catch people's attention. That's where an all-in-one keyword tool like Ahrefs can help. It identifies low competitive keywords for you to target, helping you edge into the SERPs. Ahrefs digs into your keywords and backlinks that are driving traffic to your competitors. All you have to do is replicate their strategy and watch your web traffic multiply. That's cool, right? But it gets better. Turns out Ahrefs is offering a 7-day trial for only $7. Yes, you heard that right, only $7. Plus, they've recently opened up two of their tools, Site Audit and Site Explorer, for free use. The offer is only for verified websites. So head over to ahrefs.com to sign up. They also have a great blog and a YouTube channel with step-by-step SEO tutorials. Don't forget to check them out. All right, you guys, so we got Eric Qualman here today. You guys, super excited about this. Most of you obviously on the podcast know who he is, but if you don't know who he is, we're going to do just a few minutes of just kind of getting to know him a little bit. If you guys haven't seen him on stage, if you haven't read his books, you're going to have to, during COVID times, you have plenty of time right now. You need to go out and buy his books. We'll talk about that. The books that he's had in his book right now, The Focus Project, which thank you so much for sending me a copy. I just started reading some of it this morning and realized that I need to focus in my life. Like, that's not even like, it's like, I'm going to have to read your whole book just in one shot just to show people that I can focus. So that's the goal. So where did you grow up? Give us a little background here.
So I grew up in Detroit, outside of Detroit, and loved it, right? Fell into the car automotive business like everyone does up there. Right. But I fell on the digital side of things. And so as an intern, helped program Cadillac.com at the time, their first website.
Wow.
It's been in the digital space forever. So that led me to books like the first book, Socialnomics. And yeah, then now my sixth book, The Focus Project. So it's been an awesome ride. You know, we're just trying to entertain, educate, and empower people to their best life. So that's where I grew up, is outside of Detroit.
That's awesome. And so how big of a family did you guys have?
I've got two brothers, and then I've got both my parents. So five total. It's great.
Nice, nice, nice. And so give us an interesting fact. I know you grew up in Detroit, so it was like everybody was in the car industry. Like, I think it was illegal not to be in the car industry if you grew up in Detroit. Got any interesting facts about family, anything nobody's heard, or maybe some interesting facts that was kind of crazy stuff?
Yeah, Madonna's from my hometown, Rochester, Michigan.
And hello, then there we go.
Also, let's see, I walked on the basketball team at Michigan State, got a full ride scholarship. So that was interesting. And part of the reason I made the team is because I got my teeth knocked out. That was the whole reason I think I made the team and got a scholarship. So,
wow, you sacrificed your teeth for education.
Yeah. Sacrifice them.
That's good. My son's in college right now. I wish he would do that because it would save me some money. I'm not saying I don't want him to have his teeth, but I'm just saying like that would be awesome if he would. I guess then I'd have to pay for his teeth. Maybe we'll just do the college thing. We'll just pay for the college thing.
It's easier that way. Lower teeth.
There we go. So, I mean, who needs the lower teeth, right? I mean, people just really care about the upper teeth. And so you went to college, you went to Michigan, right?
I went to Michigan State University. I went to the basketball school. Michigan's the football school.
Yeah, you were Spartans, right? Is that what it is?
Yeah, go green.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
Coach Izzo's still the coach there, Hall of Famer, great guy. Awesome. Love that guy.
That's crazy. And I know, so you got there on a scholarship for basketball. How tall are you?
On a sunny day, I'm 6'7", but I normally like to be a little more understated, so 6'6".
Yeah, so 6'6", and the green glasses don't give you weight. You're currently in Austin, right? Do you live in Austin?
Live in Austin, Texas, yes, sir.
So you can't avoid anything. Like, you're 6'6", 6'7", on a good day, probably 6'9", if you have heels on, which I'm not saying you wear heels, but my point is, and with the green glasses, like, there's just no getting away.
Yeah. Teaches me to walk in discomfort each and every day, which is kind of ironic because that's not why we did it. But all of a sudden, that's what we talk about on stage, as we talk about in the books. If you want to grow, you got to have that discomfort. You mentioned your son's a physical specimen working out. He's not getting stronger by being comfortable. He's got to push the limits, right? And so that's how you get stronger. That's how you break down muscle and grow it.
That's exactly it. Yeah. I tell them, if you do the same exercises for 2 years, you're not going to see any progress. You gotta shock the muscles. And the same thing with the brain, right? I think that's what you guys are pitching, is like, hey, the idea is like, if you're comfortable, you're not growing, right? You gotta be almost uncomfortable. Actually, do have to be uncomfortable. So let's talk about this. So you talked a little bit about, obviously, with Cadillac, and I know that you think you worked with Pontiac. There was a number of car dealerships or big car manufacturers. Is that how you got in the digital space? So out of college, you just jumped into the obviously digital side, but on working with automotive companies?
Yeah, I was on the internship, and the world was shifting, and they needed websites. And so there were brand new things. And so they go, give it to that young guy. Like, he probably understands some of this technology we don't understand at all. And so fell into it backwards, loved it. And digital used to be like tiny, like the nerds in the corner.
Yeah,
thing.
Yeah.
And then so it was the right place, right time when we wrote the first book, Socialnomics, because then it just exploded. But I've been in the digital space now 26 years. So it's been fun. It's been a wild ride. But I'm always face-to-face first. And so that's why I always tell them, I'm really more Flintstones than Jetsons, even though I love the Jetsons side of things. It's always that balance.
Yeah, for sure. And then tell us a little bit, like, you started at QualmanObviously.com, talk to me a little bit about that. Like, when did you start that? Because honestly, I looked at your bio, like what you've done, and I would love to interview you probably for 20 to 30 hours, and it still wouldn't be enough time. Like, I'm like, we should talk about what you haven't done, because there's like two things, I think. But let's talk about the website. Let's talk about that. When did you guys start that, and what was the reason for starting it?
Yeah, no, good question. So my career, I worked at Yahoo back when the Facebook of the day. I worked at head of marketing at Travels Company Public, which was a great ride. And so I've worked for big and small companies along the way. And then when I was the head of marketing at Travelzoo, I wrote a book called Socialnomics, mainly out of frustration, because I was sitting there going, hey, you guys, the world's shifting. Can you not see it? This isn't just for teenagers. This social media is like so much bigger than even media. It's just the fundamentally shift how we communicate. And so out of frustration, I was speaking at search engine conferences. And so people thought I was a crazy guy. Who's this guy talking about this teenage stuff? My buddy came up to me and goes, hey, I know everyone thinks you're crazy, but here's the name of my publisher. I'll set up a meeting. You need to write a book. Go talk to them. And I go, great. I've got like a million rejection letters from my fiction book, but I'll give a business book a try.
Yeah.
So that meeting went well. They love the name Socialnomics. Away we go. The reason I tell you that, because you asked about the website. So then we have a website, socialnomics.com, and then also equalman.com. Socialnomics.com is basically just my blog. It started as a blog. Then it grew into this huge thing, kind of like Arianna Huffington, not to that scale, but that's that model.
Yeah,
and
for
so
sure.
It's still alive today. It makes revenue. But equalman.com is just where people want me to book me to speak, or they want some of our free educational materials. That's where they go to get that edutainment. It's what we call it.
Edutainment, like that, education and entertainment together, huh? And as of today, you've spoken, 55 countries, 50 million people. So small numbers, right? I mean, that's not really that big of a deal. Oh, wait, let me take that back. That's huge. 55 million countries. Obviously, that's kind of, I mean, my speaking is nowhere close to what you've done country-wise. I think I'm like at like four countries or something. So I'm really on your heels. So be very careful. But the thing is, I mean, how has this changed with the pandemic in regards to the speaking events? I will tell you, we're going to talk about this later, is the Focus Project. I don't think that book could have came out at a better time in regards to people needing to focus with the crazy stuff, because it's always difficult. But tell us a little bit about that. How's the pandemic changed in regards to, you know, speaking events and stuff you got going on?
Yeah, no, it's been a learning. It's great, because we always talk about walking in discomfort. We talk about digital leadership in a lot of the books, and obviously on the digital media that we have in terms of digital leadership, but zero, right? So all of a sudden live events go to zero. So what industry just goes completely zero overnight? Live events.
Yeah.
And so you can never even ever anticipate something going to zero, especially coming off record years. Like, we had record years the 3 years prior, record January, February. But we're going to come out of it better. And so we're already innovating. So to your point, almost all the events have gone virtual. Some have just said, hey, we're just going to go to next year. And hopefully next year comes back to some kind of normal. But fortunately, since I own an animation studio, we were better poised than most. So I've called it, let's dust off some of our other things that we haven't really put a focus on. And let's bring those back up to life a little more love than before, which made sense. Like, we were focused on the things that made sense during that world. Now that the world has shifted 100% almost, then we've been able to focus on the other things. So it's been like everyone else, challenging,
yeah,
but also fun from a standpoint of we're starting to innovate. So it's great.
See, that's, it's funny. So we kind of had some of the same situation where it's like, you know, you're in this, all of a sudden speaking stopped, all this stops, and you're like, man, now what do we do? But I tell you what it's helped us do is really focus on our business. Because before I was traveling and running around and doing this, and you get very busy, right? And it's hard to focus on, there's something has to fall out, right? You have, there's only so many hours in the day. And I do think that it's helped us really look at our business and really reevaluate some of the expenses we had, other things that we were doing. You know, the speaking stuff, it was great, great. There's some good money there, but we're really getting any clients from it. So it really, for us, it, I think the same thing. It sucks for that minute. You're like, okay, now I got to figure this out. Now I got to figure out how I'm going to pivot, or how do I, you know, make the best of this. And so for you, it's like, hey, we can focus on the, you know, the not the digital side, but the videos and produce the stuff you guys are doing for Disney. I mean, you guys have done some really big videos and stuff, you know, on that side. So I think that's awesome that it's like, you know, you actually had a, probably a chance. For me, it was like, now I'm at the house and I'm like, I actually have some time now. I actually, right, I'm grounded now. I'm not out there running around kind of like all over the place. Now I actually can focus on some stuff that maybe I haven't put that time into. So it's kind of, once again, that's a blessing to have for sure.
Yeah, take advantage of this time, because it's not, hopefully not going to happen again, but it is an opportunity to do certain things like you just mentioned exactly. It also just asks, when you're stuck, how can I provide value? So I told my team, hey, look, how can we help this situation? And so we started doing some moving graphs early on, because I asked our animators, I go, hey, if we can look into a data source like a John Hopkins or some other source, can we provide some moving graphs? Because we have the animation skills.
Yeah,
and
sure.
They said, yeah, we can do it. I go, done. Let's do it tomorrow. And they go, well, that's not going to generate revenue. I go, but it's helping.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden, lo and behold, what happens? We posted on TikTok. We don't have a ton of followers on TikTok. We're like 10,000. And then all of a sudden, someone else reposted 21 million views. And so we're like, wow, we really helped people. So that at the end of the day, sometimes you're stuck. A lot of your listeners, just ask how you can provide value, and that'll lead you down the right path.
Yeah, that's awesome. We did, I actually kind of on a different level, but we did something somewhat similar. Long story short, we have the SBA, obviously, that's given all kinds of money to small businesses. And I actually started working with the SBA to help businesses transition from offline to online. And that's been kind of my focus, because once again, it's not, you know, I don't make as much money there if I was to do actual consulting, but the thing is that we're able to help more people, and that's what's needed, right? I mean, it's this crazy time of like social and websites, e-commerce, like, well, I'll work on that in 6 months or something. And COVID hits and you're like, I'm way behind. Like, I need to do this tomorrow, right? So I think it's awesome. You looked at it kind of how we looked at it, is like, well, how can we help people, right? Because this is a crazy time and it's unprecedented. And like, how can we add some value to people when right now everybody's going, what do I do? Like, I have my brick and mortar. I've been there 30 years. I finally got it to where I want it to be. And now I want to sell it in 5 years and retire. And now I'm like, you know, festivals are gone, or restaurants are, you know, every week it's a questionable and whether it's going to happen or not, are going to open back up. So yeah, I mean, it's a kind of crazy times, but once again, I think because of that, I think some opportunity will happen as well. Thanks, Eric. It was great talking with you. From digital nerd to proclaimed keynote speaker, that's one hell of a journey. And your COVID survival strategy really blew me away. But folks, this is just the tip of the iceberg. Eric has a lot more secrets up his sleeve. Hopefully, he will reveal them in our next episode. So stay tuned to Shane Barker's Marketing Growth Podcast.